Vowel tension is another dimension that should be addressed. Historically, some pairs have been divided up into tense, lax pairs. It was originally thought that the tense vowel in each pair was produced with actual extramuscular effort, or tension, in the tongue. Later research has not borne this idea out, but the terms tense and lax have persisted. It's now thought that these qualities of vowels are more related to ways in which different vowels occur with other sounds and words. We'll talk a little bit more about this idea later in the course. For now, just remember that some vowels occur in pairs where one is considered to be tense and the other is considered lax. In addition, we should talk about rounding of vowels. Although the main articulator for vowels is the tongue, there is a set of vowels that are regularly produced with the lips rounded in addition to the articulation of the tongue. In English, these vowels are all back vowels, such as O, U, and U. In fact, rounding is considered to be such an essential component of these vowels that if one of these vowels is produced without rounding, it would be considered to be a different vowel. Finally, some vowels are produced in a steady state, while others have a change during their production. In steady state vowels, there is no change in the vowel's quality from the beginning of the production to the end. Steady state vowels are called monophthongs. I suppose this means that there's one phthong. But I'll be honest and say that I have no idea what a phthong is, and this term isn't used in any discussions of phonetics that I've been a part of. Now, other vowels are produced with a notable change in vowel quality across the production of the vowel. An example of this kind of vowel is I. This vowel sounds like ah at the beginning and something like I or e at the end. Because there are two identifiable components of these vowels, they're called diphthongs. As above, this likely means that there are two phthongs. But don't worry about phthongs, just worry about what you can hear. If you hear two parts, then it's a diphthong. The way that I think about diphthongs is that they're analogous to affricate consonants. Remember how ch is not really two sounds next to each other, but rather one sound made up of two parts? Well, that's just like what a diphthong is. A diphthong isn't really two vowels right next to each other. It's one vowel that's made up of a starting quality and an ending quality. And just like with affricates, we use two symbols to represent diphthongs, and some people like to connect those two symbols with a ligature to indicate how they go together. Also, just like affricates, I don't require the use of ligatures. If you want to use them, please go ahead, but I don't personally use them, and I'll be fine if you don't use them too. Now, there are two different types of diphthongs that are often recognized, phonemic and non-phonemic. The phonemic diphthongs are a little bit easier. They're the sounds that everyone thinks of as diphthongs. In English, these include I, ow, and oi. The non-phonemic diphthongs are diphthongs by virtue mostly of common production characteristics of American English. In other words, these don't have to be diphthongs, and in fact, in many languages, these sounds are produced as steady-state monophthong vowels. But in English, we add a little bit of an off-glide to these vowels almost all of the time. And because there's such a strong pattern in English, and because this pattern sets English pronunciation a bit apart from pronunciation in most other languages, we want to recognize this part of English phonetics in our transcription. The two non-phonemic diphthongs in English are A and O. You'll find some textbooks transcribing these vowels as the monophthongs A and O. They mean the same thing, but they've opted to use a different convention to represent these vowels. In this class, I want you to transcribe these vowels as diphthongs in order to recognize this characteristic of the English vowel system. So even in the basic vowel charts I'll show you, you'll see that there is some variation in whether these two vowels are represented as monophthongs or diphthongs, but in our transcriptions for this class, we'll represent them as diphthongs. In the next movie, we'll put together the various qualities of vowels that we've discussed so far into a vowel chart.